We are live now.
Vastupyam varade kamarupini Saraswati namastupyam varade kamarupini vidyarambam karishyami siddhe bhavatu me sada vidyarambam karishyami siddhe bhavatu me sada.
Good evening to you all. IACI welcomes you to this new webinar series, which we have decided to start. And December is the first month of the first in the series of the webinar, which we had planned to do it as a monthly event for this coming year. Basically, this will focus on the recent advances, news update, clinical radiological discussions, interesting topics related to cardiovascular imaging, which will be covered by our national and the international speakers for the same. Today, first topic will be on myocardial strain imaging. A young dynamic cardiothoracic imaging specialist is going to speak on it, followed by a renowned cardiologist who will give the clinical perspective, which is very important for us as radiologists to know. We have the moderator, Dr. Vimal Raj. Dr. Vimal Raj needs no introduction, but for those who probably are not do not know him, he is basically a consulting thoracic radiologist. He's basically heading the team at Narayana Rudralaya in Bangalore. He has got various affiliations at Royal Brompton, Papworth, and Glenfield. He has multiple publications as seen on your screen. I will now hand over the screen dash to Dr. Vimal Raj to moderate this session. Dr. Vimal Raj, can I have you on the screen dash?
Thank you, Dr. Hemant. Very good evening to all of you. And I would first like to congratulate both Dr. Hemant Telkar and Dr. Priya for coming up with this fantastic idea of focusing on specific topics and bringing detailed discussions into this. So that is what we are going to be doing today. This is the first part of the entire series, and it's really encouraging to see you all being here And I hope we will be able to do justice and give you some new pearls into this. So without ado, I would first like to invite Dr. Priya Chudgar. Dr. Priya is one of the great and upcoming cardiac radiologists in the country. Dr. Priya is currently working in Jupiter Hospital, Mumbai. And I've known Priya for the last nearly 8 years now. And the enthusiasm and the energy she has to learn cardiac imaging and to deliver that has been fantastic. Just putting things in context here for everybody is that the myocardial strain imaging is something which is very well recognized as a tool which is going to help us in detecting diseases at a much earlier stage. And also it is going to give us a lot of inputs on how we manage our patients. Both Dr. Priya Chudgar and Dr. Burkule, who is our next faculty, both are perhaps one of the first few adopters of this technology in the country. And hence we are really happy to have them here. And we are looking forward to hearing from them. So Dr. Priya is recently certified for CBCMR and has the fellowship of the Society of Cardiac MR. So very well done on that, Priya. Followed by Dr. Priya, we're going to be listening from Dr. Nitin Burkule. And I will introduce Dr. Nitin Burkule closer to his time. So we're going to start off with Dr. Priya Chudgar's talk. She is going to talk to us on myocardial strain imaging and CMR feature tracking applications and its limitations. Off to you, Priya.
Hello, I'm Dr. Priya Chudgar, and I'm going to talk about strain imaging today. Cardiac MRI is considered as one-stop shop modality. LG imaging for myocardial characterization has been one of the very strong points. T1, T2 mapping and phase contrast with flow mapping are also another feather. However, coming to function side, till date, ejection fraction was considered as gold standard for quantifying ventricular function. But it is not an ideal measure for contractility because it is not sensitive to regional abnormalities. And also, some diseases process may reach irreversible stage when EF is reduced. Strain imaging is considered as has established itself as a very good diagnostic tool in 2D echocardiography. And after the advances in the speckle tracking cardiography, strain imaging has really evolved. So let us understand what is strain imaging. Strain basically means deformation. Look at this spring. The spring is deformed when the weight is applied. Weight is increased or decreased, the deformation will change. In the myocardium, this deformation imaging is called as strain imaging. And the force is actually the amount of stress to the myocardium. But it is not that simple and clear when it comes to heart, because in heart muscle, there is lengthening and shortening, twisting and untwisting. And also the myocardial muscles are arranged in different pattern. There is also clockwise, anti-clockwise rotation of the heart. The fibers are arranged in different layers like subendocardial, mid-myocardial, epicardial in different pattern. And all this myocardial mechanics are difficult to understand. As we see over here, there is clockwise rotation of the base of the heart and anti-clockwise rotation of the apex of the heart, which leads to another amount of torsion of the heart. The myocardial fibers are also arranged in different pattern, different helix, left-handed and right-handed helix, as we see in this case. So the myocardial movement, the fiber movement occurs in three directions, longitudinal, circumferential, that is along the perimeter, and as well as radial. So this leads to different types of strain. Longitudinal strain, as we see, is basically longitudinal shortening of myocardial fibers from base to apex, while circumferential is basically shortening along the circular parameter. Radial is thickening towards the center of the ventricular cavity, and torsion, which is actually rotation of the apex relative to the base. Measurement of the strain is based on Lagrangian strain, which is strain is actually unitless, and the deformed myocardium itself is used as reference. So when we consider that, for example, if from the length of 10 centimeter, the fiber shortens to 8 centimeter, it is considered that there is 20% reduction, 20% shortening, which leads to a strain of minus 20%. While similarly, when from 10 centimeter, if the fiber lengthens to 12 centimeter, the strain will be positive, it will be plus 20%. If there is no change in length, it will be zero. Okay. However, also there is a difference in the strain rate. Amount of time taken for the lengthening or shortening will also vary with different myocardium, and that is how the strain rate is different. Negative and positive values. As we see over here, that whenever there is lengthening to shortening, it is given as a negative value. While whenever there is thinning, from thickening to thinning, that is also will be given negative value, which leads to the conclusion that longitudinal and circumferential strain will be expressed as negative value, while radial strain, basically which leads to thickening, will be always a positive value. Amongst all the strain parameters, longitudinal strain of the global myocardium, also called as GLS, global longitudinal strain, is most reproducible and validated. Compared to all other parameters like end diastolic volume, end systolic volume, ejection fraction, GLS, that is global longitudinal strain, is most reproducible and validated. So that can be considered as a new parameter for global LV function. It is robust, reproducible, and this can serve as a valuable complement to traditional function parameters. However, there are inter-vendor differences. Different machines, different softwares have different values or different range of the GLS that we will go through it. Why CMR? So when we talk about echo and CMR, they always go hand in hand when it comes to better patient outcome in clinical patient management. When echo is advancing in the field of strain imaging, CMR also should not be left behind. The advantage is that CMR we are already doing for some other clinical indications. Along with LG, along with ejection fraction, if CMR can also provide strain values, that will be beneficial. There are no acoustic window limitations. It is not related to body habitus. And with feature tracking method, there is no additional time, no separate sequences required. Different CMR methods for strain imaging. There could be tagging methods using phase contrast methods or feature tracking. We will try and cover feature tracking in detail in this parameter because it is done along based on the normally obtained sequences. There are no additional time, no sequences required. You just require a good post-processing software. And new companies, all the vendors will be providing this strain imaging very soon. Tagging, also known as SPAM and complementary SPAM, where we can see the myocardial tags, which can be applied in end diastole. However, it is long and there is complex image processing involved. SENC gives inline, that will be a direct visualization of the LV strain. However, it is not that clearly visualized. It is a color-coded strain map can be obtained, but the radial strain cannot be calculated, and it is different sequence, different time. So it is mainly used for research purposes. Dense, basically it has low SNR. It is like phase contrast displacement encoding with stimulated echoes. However, this is also some limitation because it is mainly used for research purposes. Different sequences like tagging, SENC, dense, all of them have, they are reproducible. But however, you require additional sequence, additional time, and it has some limited role with the different post-processing tools. Feature tracking has an advantage that there is no separate acquisition required. It is automated and routinely obtained CNA-SSFP sequences can be used for calculation of myocardial stream. So let us go through CMR feature tracking method. Basically, it uses the normal standard SSFP sequence. It uses an optical flow method to track features on the consecutive frames. For longitudinal stream, we require long axis images, that is 2-chamber, 3-chamber and 4-chamber views. Then we contour the endocardial and epicardial contours are defined. We define the mitral annular plane. All this is what we do it routinely for ejection fraction, same protocol, but in three planes, that is 2C, 3C and 4C. When it comes to circumferential strain, you require short axis images. Radial strain again can be seen on long and short axis images. As we see over here, in CMR feature tracking, you define a point and the same point is tracked throughout the cardiac cycle. And this can help to calculate the strain mapping. The contours have to be accurately traced. Normally, most of the software can actually, they are doing it very beautifully, and this has to be propagated throughout the cardiac cycle. So for LS, longitudinal strain and radial strain, long axis view, and for circumferential strain, short axis views are obtained. Just giving a demo example, these three views are together put in the strain module. We have to define the endocardial and epicardial contour. The SSFP images have a unique, very good blood to myocardium interface. So it can really draw the contours very well. Check your contours regular, whether they are, you know, through the endocardium and epicardium, and then you can apply the strain post-processing tool, CMR feature tracking. And it can give value like this of the 17 segment myocardium or a total value, a quantitative parameter of the LV global longitudinal strain. Color-coded maps can also be obtained. So these measurements can be displayed as a particular value, as a quantitative measurement, different color-coded display. You can also obtain strain time curve, or you can also use it on the polar plot. So all this information you get after applying your strain post-processing software. Normal values are highly variable. It definitely depends on the different machine and software. However, the normal range of GLS varies from minus 19 to minus 23. Minus 20 is considered as normal, and the same thing is correlated with the echo literature also. However, these are global values and not for the individual slice. And ideally, we should have a normal reference range for your machine, similar to what we do it for the T1, T2 mapping. There are different factors which affect the value of GLS. Most importantly, image quality. So when you have a lot of artifacts, you won't be able to get a good endocardial contour. The values will not be so accurate then. Even a good spatial and temporal resolution, ideally minimum 25 phases of cardiac cycle, that is with good temporal resolution, those images only should be used for the strain imaging. Pre and post contrast as well. As you see over here, in the post contrast images, the differentiation of endomyocardial contour will not be that clear. So your strain again will not be that accurate. Also, as seen, different softwares may have some differences with the post-processing algorithm, and that may also lead to difference in values. Few other points for accurate find results. Good images are the key. Correct planning of your views. We should have that correct planning of the four chamber view, especially where there is no foreshortening. That will lead to overestimation of underestimation of the results. We should take care that you don't include LVOT or atrium in your contour measurements. Otherwise, that will lead to false results. Apart from that, there are few other strain parameters which are also research in progress. They are used for, you know, there are potential applications which are in research, like strain rate. Strain rate is basically, as we have seen, the time to obtain the different time which is taken for that strain value, particular strain value. It is the rate by which myocardial deformation occurs. And this has been evaluated for the ischemic and non-ischemic cardiomyopathy. And time to peak strain has been also used for the ventricular dyssynchrony. Let us go through a few clinical applications. One of the most common area where GLS, global longitudinal strain, is used is heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. 40% of the heart failure patients can have normal ejection fraction. As we see in this diagram, that ejection fraction can be normal in so many cases still for a long time, and then there will be deterioration, by which diastolic dysfunction and the longitudinal deformation are one, two other parameters where we can pick up the early changes related to the myocardium, and early detection will be the key, and then you can definitely help the patient. As seen in this case, no significant change in ejection fraction, but there is striking difference between the global longitudinal strain. As seen in this case, the GLS is reduced, which means that this patient has to be treated with cardioprotective therapy. Other common area where it is used and validated is the cancer therapy related cardiac dysfunction. Breast cancer, and especially women receiving chemotherapy with anthracycline drugs, it is known that they are prone to have cardiac damage. Cardiotoxicity related to chemotherapy drugs is the leading cause of mortality and morbidity in breast cancer patients. The myocardial damage can be like permanent damage, especially with anthracycline, or it could be even with rifoximab and trastuzumab, reversible damage. In the recent AHFA scientific statement, echo as well as CMR and strain imaging have been advocated to detect early changes of myocardial function. And in case if there is a drop of GLS more than 15%, quantitative assessment is GLS is taken, and because it is more sensitive predictor for LV dysfunction. And if there is a drop of GLS of more than 15% from baseline values, appropriate therapy should be started, as is seen in this case. So from GLS has dropped more than 15% from the baseline to the next visit, then we know that there is early changes of the systolic dysfunction has started happening, and patient should be started with appropriate cardioprotective regime, as well as decision to modify the chemotherapy can be taken. Another area is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Strain values may be normal in abnormal in overt or subclinical HCM. And also it is one of the important marker for the first degree relative who do not have any phenotypic disease. Lower strain values will be more prediction of VT and appropriate ICD discharge. And it is reduced LA strain is also, there are few studies which have shown this as a poor prognostic marker. As seen in this case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, reduced LGA strain values in the global as well as regional walls of hypertrophy can be seen. Another area is amyloid cardiomyopathy. Amyloid cardiomyopathy has classical imaging features, but this strain values and will be one of the marker for the all-cause mortality. LG imaging, T1 mapping values, and this classical pattern of apical sparing will clinch the diagnosis. On the 2D echo, it has been described as cherry on top, where there is apical sparing and more involvement of the base of the myocardium, as seen in this case. Another area is left ventricular non-compaction. All other non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, strain parameters are decreased even with normal LV values. So non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, hereditary cardiomyopathies are other areas where strain imaging can be used. As is seen in this case of left ventricular non-compaction, the strain values are significantly reduced. Ischemic heart disease. All strain components are decreased in ischemic heart disease. Strain imaging is very sensitive to detect early subclinical dysfunction, and sometimes even regional values can be of help. There is always another characteristic thing is early lengthening, that is early stretch, a decreased systolic strain, and a peak systolic shortening. These are classical of ischemic heart disease. And depending on the transmurality and infarct size, strain values will vary. Myocarditis, and especially with COVID era, we have seen few cases in which there was normal or preserved LVEF, no LGE, but abnormal strain values were seen in few cases. Hereditary cardiomyopathy, like Becker's or Duchenne muscular dystrophy, the strain values also will be abnormal. That will help to provide, to favor more the diagnosis and to assess the severity. LV strain can also help to differentiate different causes of LV hypertrophy, and moreover to differentiate athletes from other pathologic causes of hypertrophy, because athletes or healthy individuals will have normal strain values. Dilated cardiomyopathy. Impaired strain values will be actually as a marker for the disease pathology, and it can also serve to in help of degree of heterogeneity of the strain throughout the cardiac cycle. In dyssynchrony, we can actually find out the septal lateral delay and the time of the strain which is taken from the septum to the lateral wall. And this septal lateral delay, if it is more than a particular range, probably the CRT, that cardiac resynchronization therapy, will be more active. Patient will be responder. This patient of LVBB, there is good amount of septal lateral delay. Along with this timing, no scar on the LGE, these features will tell the clinician that this patient will be a better responder for CRT therapy. Few other areas where work is in progress is for the valvular heart disease. Impaired strain, regardless of the symptoms, will help in timing of the surgery. Few congenital heart disease like TOF will also have reduced strain values. Pulmonary hypertension, there will be a reduced RV strain related to the severity of pulmonary hypertension. Heart transplant, this will be one of the major predictor for major adverse event. Coming to limitations, as we have seen earlier, the standardization of GLS is still in progress. The values are variable with different vendors, with different post-processing softwares, and as well as with different techniques. The reproducibility and validation still needs to be covered before we come to use it as a quantitative parameter. Most important is quality of the acquisition images. So all these factors we really need to work on. However, this is one very important tool in our toolbox, because there is no additional time for scan acquisition. We are doing MRI for some other clinical indication. And along with that, along with LG, along with other parameters, if we have this strain values, that would be definitely an additional parameter which will help in prognosis and diagnosis. It helps in differentiating disease when tissue characterization is not possible, as we saw, to differentiate athlete from the other causes of the LV wall hypertrophy. And finally, this will definitely improve our diagnostic skills and impact treatment decisions. To summarize, ECHO has already advanced in the era in the field of strain imaging. Now the baton is passed on to CMR. It is a very objective method. It gives up quantitative measurements. It is easy to use. There is no additional time required. However, the validation, more work is needed, and we just have to use it before we lose it. Thank you.
Excellent, Priya. I think that was really fantastic representation of what we are looking at, and very excited, to be honest. I'm very excited to be seeing this, and some questions are coming in. I've got some questions as well. We'll deal with the questions in the end, and I think it is apt time for us to introduce Dr. Nitin Burkule. Dr. Nitin Burkule is a dear friend and one of the renowned cardiologists in the country, who is so enthusiastic. I remember us being in some of the events together, and he wants to learn. He's one of those guys who really wants to learn and has got excellent knowledge of the heart anatomy and physiology. And we were in a course together on cardiac MR, and I learned a lot from him. So he is the director of the cardiology department at Jupiter Hospital in Thane. And he's a consultant cardiologist with extensive experience. He's one of those guys, I think, one of the top guys in India when it comes to imaging of the heart, be it echo, be it any other modality. So it's extreme pleasure to have Dr. Nitin Burkule with us. And he is going to talk to us and tell us about the clinical utility of strain imaging and comparison of echo with cardiac MR in this modality. Dr. Nitin, again, welcome. Really looking forward to your talk. And we will have a panel discussion and get the questions and answers sorted for all the people who are listening in. Please do put your questions in the Q&A section of where you are, and I will be putting these questions to the faculty at the end of the talk. So over to Dr. Nitin Burkule now.
Dear friends, let us discuss about the strain in echocardiography. Now, strain in echocardiography is quite matured because it is there around for almost 15 years. We want to understand the myocardium, and the ways to understand the myocardium is the strain imaging, the T1 values, the extracellular maps, and the replacement fibrosis by the LGE. Now, the strain tells you about the deformation characteristics of the myocardium, which get affected by the interstitial fibrosis or replacement fibrosis. One thing we should know is that the myocardium is arranged in the helical fibers, in the helical way. So the subendocardial fibers are arranged in a right-hand helix, and these subendocardial fibers are needed for the longitudinal contraction. So therefore, the global longitudinal strain is more affected by the subendocardial helical fibers. Now, this is how the global longitudinal strain looks on echocardiography. You get a polar map and you get a global value. The same thing can be displayed as the time and strain map for each of this segment. Similarly, if you have a 3D data set of the echocardiography, then you can have the global longitudinal strain, the global circumferential strain, and the global radial strain, all measurements done with a single set of 3D data set. Similarly, when you have a short axis view, you can measure the radial strain and also the circumferential strain. And this short axis view is also useful for the rotational characteristics of the left ventricle. Now, these are the normal values of the global longitudinal strain on the echocardiography, which is around minus 20. The circumferential strain can range from 24 to 28. The radial strain has got a tremendous variability, and it's not so well standardized. Let us look at certain cases. So this is a 72-year-old lady who is a diabetic. She had a past history of paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. She is obese. She has class 2 dyspnea. Now she is a regular patient of any cardiology OPD. Now echo looks fine. There is a nice contractility of the ventricle. There is no regional wall motion abnormality. The EF is definitely normal. Look at the short axis view, perfectly fine. But just look at the global longitudinal strain. It is minus 14.6. That means this lady, despite having a normal ejection fraction and being almost asymptomatic, she already has started developing subclinical cardiomyopathy, and her global longitudinal strain has significantly dropped, which is minus 14, almost a 6% point drop. Now, this global longitudinal strain is more sensitive marker of a preclinical LV dysfunction. It predicts the fall of the left ventricular ejection fraction, and it also predicts the LV remodeling, future admissions for heart failure, and also mortality. Let us look at this lady's RV function. The right ventricle looks perfectly fine, contracting well, and so also the Doppler, tissue Doppler of the tricuspid annulus. However, let us look at her strain of the RV free wall. And this is actually quite compromised. It is minus 18. Generally, the RV free wall strain would be in the range of 24-25. So the thing is, that is how this strain is useful for picking up a subclinical disease. Let us look at this gentleman, 32-year-old male, who has a very good physical effort capacity, but he is diagnosed with Hodgkin's disease. And he is here Hodgkin's lymphoma, and he is on a Adriamycin-containing regime. So this is in September. We have this echocardiogram. The EF is perfectly fine, and the GL is minus 20. Now, he, over the next 2 months, he receives the 2 cycles, and we see him at 10th November. And let us look at the 2D images. The ejection fraction looks perfectly fine. But what has happened to the GLS? The GLS is minus 15%. So there is a 5% point fall in the GLS. Now, this is early cardiomyopathy produced by Adriamycin. So the thing is, the longitudinal studies have shown that a longitudinal strain fall of more than 10% actually predicts the future fall of LV ejection fraction almost 6 months before. Now, this is the data from the same study. The red bars indicate the fall in the GLS after starting Adriamycin, and the blue bars show you the fall in the ejection fraction. As you can see that at 8 months point, there is a significant drop in ejection fraction, but this was predicted by the fall in the GLS just at the 4 months data set. So the fall in the GLS always tells you about the future fall in the ejection fraction and can alert you of the Adriamycin-induced cardiomyopathy so that you can start the ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, spironolactone. Let us look at another case. This is a 63-year-old male presented to the emergency department with atypical chest pain. He's a diabetic, non-hypertensive, non-smoker. Now, always in the emergency room, when you see an ECG, which is normal, you generally take an echo and look for a regional wall motion abnormality. Now, looking at the regional wall motion abnormality, I don't think there is any regional wall motion abnormality. The LV is contracting well. There is no regional akinesia. So let us see how these patients are managed. Generally, when you are suspecting an acute ischemia, you are looking for a myocardial necrosis. So you send troponins. The troponins are generally available within 1 hour from the lab. But the same thing, the ischemia also affects your subendocardial fiber. So there is a subendocardial contractile dysfunction, and which can be picked up by the strain imaging. So let us look at this patient's strain, and we can easily see that the apical segments do not show a good strain values. The strain values which are in this particular region of blue shows that these strains are terribly low, while the red ones tell you that this is a normal strain. So we already know that there is a left ventricle under descending territory segments are showing a very low strain. So this patient's bullseye already shows you a hole at the apex. And let us look at his angio. You can see a very critical left ventricle descending artery there. At the same time, obviously, he also has multivessel disease, but probably the LED was the culprit for the patient's angina. Let's look at this case. He's a 54-year-old doctor. He was actually a dentist, non-diabetic, non-hypertensive. His CT coronary angio was done 2 years back, which was perfectly normal. He had chest pain on exertion. He had a normal resting ECG. So he was turned on twice from the cardiologist's office. So this is his echo when he climbed one flight of staircase to our echo lab. And you don't find any regional wall motion abnormality here. Let us turn on the strain in this particular patient. The moment you turn the strain on here, let us look at the segments at the apex and let us look at the strain time graphs. So you can see that the apical segment show a post-systolic shortening. You can see this green graph here. So this is the aortic wall closure. And after the closure, there is a continued contraction of the apical segments. This post-systolic shortening is generally associated with either a repetitive stunning or a very significant resting ischemia. And the same thing is, if you look at the bull's eye of his strain, you can see that there's a reduced strain at the apex. And let us look at his angio, and you can see that there's a very, very significant proximal LAD disease. So the thing is, the strain has always been used even for the viability assessment. Now, if you look at this segment number one, which is normal, segment number two, which has recovered after revascularization, and segment number three, which are the segments which have not recovered after revascularization, you can see that the post-systolic strain or the global longitudinal strains continues to reduce from the normal segments to the segments which are not recovered after revascularization. So that is how it can even predict viability to a certain extent. In another study, what they looked at was the trans myocardial enhancement. Now, the patients with the trans myocardial enhancement less than 50% versus more than 50%, if you look at the global longitudinal strain in these segments which did not have microvascular obstruction versus the segments which are shown by red where there is a microvascular obstruction, you can see that consistently the segments with microvascular obstruction show a further reduction in the strain as compared to the other infarcted segments. Let us look at the role of strain in CRT. Now, we'll look at this 38-year-old lady who has a peripartum cardiomyopathy. She has a left bundle branch block, EF of 15%. She had a CRT implantation and she actually became a super responder. Her EF improved to 50-55%. And she had an LV reverse remodeling. Now, these are the leads. This is the lead in the right atrium. This is the lead in the right ventricle. And this is the lead through the coronary sinus has gone into the left ventricular epicardial surface. Now, this lady has come for the CRT evaluation, and what we did was we just turned the CRT off. We looked at her echo. Okay, it's okay. It shows a little borderline LV function. We turned the CRT on. Visually, I don't think we could make out any difference, but let us look at the strain curves of this lady. When the CRT is off, we are looking at the strain at the LV short axis, and you can see that all these segments are peaking at different intervals, at different time intervals. So there is a complete chaos. Okay, there is complete dyssynchrony. The moment we turn the CRT on, you can see that all the segments are now contracting at the same time, and they are reaching their peak strain almost at the same time point. Okay? So that is how the CRT works. Now, this is the same thing for her longitudinal strain. When the CRT is off, you can see that different segments are having their peak strain at different time points. The moment we turn the CRT on, all of them are now peaking at the same time. Okay? So this is how all the segments have got recruited by the CRT. So the CRT, let us look whether the CRT works permanently. We'll look at the case number two. This is a 66-year-old gentleman, dilated cardiomyopathy, diabetic, and he had two hospital admissions with decompensation. He has optimal medical therapy and he has a LVBP. So with a QRS duration of 150. So this is how his LV is. Very poor LV, hardly some 15% ejection fraction. Let us look at the strain radial strain of the LV short axis, and you can see that various segments are peaking at various different time points. So there's a complete chaos of contractility of various left ventricular segments. Now this patient goes for a CRT. So what we do is that we are looking at the LAO view, which is just like looking at the LV short axis, okay? And we know which is the latest activating segment. Now, if this is how the coronary sinus will be located, and these are the tributaries. So this latest activating segment with a particular tributary, if you can target it by your LV lead, nothing like it, because then you will be stimulating the latest activating segment. So this is how the lead is positioned in this patient. And as we knew that the lateral segments were the ones which were contracting the latest. So 4 months after, you can see there's an improvement in the LV ejection fraction. And not only that, if you look now at the strain curves, most of the strains are now peaking at the same time. So there's a significant amount of synchronization. Now this is after 22 months, the patient has again gone into heart failure, the LV is again dropped down, and let us look at the short axis. You can see that some of the segments are contracting while some of the segments are getting stretched. This is, we call as CRT fatigue. That means now the CRT no more works. Now this is because of the progression of fibrosis in various segments of the myocardium. That is why all the synchronized segments have now again has got desynchronized because of the progress of myopathy. Now let us look another case. This is a 52-year-old male, asymptomatic. And he's a known case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. His family, there is a history of sudden cardiac death. Now this is his echo, very classical echo with an asymmetric septal hypertrophy and a SAM. And this is his short axis showing an asymmetric septal hypertrophy, which is quite significant, along with hypertrophy of the apex. These are the CMR images of the same patient showing you the same distribution of hypertrophy. Now let us look at this strain map. Now very interestingly, the most hypertrophied segments are actually not showing good strain. Rather, this shows variable strain. That means some areas are actually getting stretched, some of them are getting compressed. So the most hypertrophied area is actually showing the worst strains, and which are also having it takes variable color shades. So it's the same thing. So if you look at the polar map, the segments, that is the septum and the anterior wall, or was the one which had got the significant hypertrophy, is actually showing very poor strains, because these areas actually have a lot of interstitial fibrosis. So that is why they are showing a very poor strain. And the same thing, you can see it on the LGs, that the septum is the most affected area with a very significant fibrosis, and that is why it has got the worst deformation, which was seen on those polar maps. Now let us look at the torsion of this patient. This is the basal LV short axis, and you can see this is the basal rotation. Now this you can also achieve because of the strain imaging, because you can measure how many degrees it is rotating. So this is the basal rotation, which is generally in the clockwise rotation. And this is the LV apex, and you can measure its anti-clockwise rotation, and this is this anti-clockwise rotation. So the base rotates clockwise, apex rotates anti-clockwise, and that is how the LV produces torsion. And the whole torsion also you can measure, and you can see that this LV is ejecting only by twisting, because it hardly has any good radial or longitudinal strain. Now let us look at this 41-year-old male who has a progressive dyspnea class 3. He has detected cardiomegaly and LVH. His two brothers have been diagnosed with very hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and this is how his echo looks. A very severe hypertrophy, hardly any longitudinal contraction, but this hypertrophy looks little different than what we saw for the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patient. And when we look at this patient's global longitudinal map, you can see that at the apex, the strains are preserved, while rest of the places, the strain has gone significantly down. This is called as the cherry on the top ice cream cone, and this is supposed to be very characteristic of amyloidosis. So this is the cherry on top kind of a GLS map. And you can see that he has got a very reduced basal rotation, very big reduced apical rotation, and a very reduced LV twist. And this is the CMR images of the same patient showing you the hypertrophy and reduced longitudinal contraction. And the moment you look at the LG, you would see that the BES and the mid segments are having very significant transneural LG, while the apex is having just a subendocular LG. And that shows you why there is an apical preservation of the strain, while the strain had significantly reduced in the mid and basal segments. And this is the technician pyrophosphate scan of the patient showing extreme uptake. Now let us look at this 52-year-old male who is hypertensive, completely asymptomatic, BP 140-90, and his known case of severe calcific aortic stenosis. Now he has got a nice LV function, he's perfectly asymptomatic, he goes for hiking, and these are his gradients. These gradients are quite significant, but he's like an asymptomatic severe aortic stenosis, which on clinical grounds you would like to conserve. His ejection fraction is 52%, gradients are 74/45, but look at the global longitudinal strain, and you can see that the global longitudinal strain is significantly reduced, and it is just -12%. So this patient, though he is asymptomatic, his hypertrophy has started becoming pathological. He has started developing interstitial fibrosis. This is the time when they should be going for actually aortic wall replacement. And this is one of the suggested plot by Dr. Marwick. And it says that if the patient's ejection fraction is above 55%, just look at the GLS. If the GLS is more than -18%, you follow them up every 1 to 2 yearly. If the GLS is between -16 to 18, follow them 6 monthly. If the GLS has dropped below -16 in these patients with severe aortic stenosis, look at their T1 and ECV. If they are abnormal, better consider an aortic wall replacement. We'll look at another case, a 44-year-old lady, class 2 dyspnea. She's operated for ASD. She has a residual PH and she has got a severe mitral regurgitation. Now, she has got significant mitral regurgitation, as you can see from the echo images. And this is the PISA showing the proximal isosurface velocity surface area, which is quite big. And this MR is definitely severe. And one can even quantify them, the same patient being quantified by cardiac MRI. You can see the stroke volume by the volumetric method is 70 ml. And at the same time, you take the aortic stroke volume by the phase contrast images. So you get a regurgitant volume of 30 and a regurgitant fraction of 40%, which is definitely a moderately severe mitral regurgitation. Now she has got a normal ejection fraction and she's asymptomatic. Then why do you worry? But let us look at her strain. And you can see that her strain is -19. You would say, okay, -20 is normal, -19, I'm not worried. But in mitral regurgitation, LV is facing a large preload and a very low afterload. So the LV should be hypercontractile. So the MR patients have GLS values of -22, -24. A GLS of -19 tells you that already the LV systolic dysfunction has set in. I will make a quick reference to left atrial strain. Now, this is another frontier which MR is definitely going to conquer. The left atrial strain is shown by this particular graph. So during systole, you have got the reservoir strain. When the LA expands, then early diastole, you have got a condyle strain. When the LA reduces in size and when the atria contracts, you have a booster strain. So there are three patterns of left atrial strain. And you can also look at the strains of various segments of left atrium, whether they have got any dispersion. So I'll show you the use of it. It's a 60-year-old lady, hypertensive, normal sinus rhythm. In July 2013, we saw her. She looked okay, fine. Ejection fraction was fine. The GLS was -20. So everything looked fine. Now in December 2014, that is almost after 19 months, she comes with a stroke and an atrial fibrillation. You can see the atrial fibrillation there. We look at the transesophageal echo and there is no LA clot, okay? So this lady has just developed atrial fibrillation and that's why probably she developed an LA clot and she came with a devastating stroke. Could we have predicted this atrial fibrillation in 1 year before? So let us look at her echo 17 months back. This was his echo 17 months back. Look at her left atrium. And we'll measure the strain, and the strain is hardly 11%. Normal LA strains are 40%. So she not only had a very significant reduction in the LA strain, but also there was a significant dispersion in the LA segment, segmental strains. So she already had developed an atrial cardiomyopathy, and she was actually had a substrate to develop atrial fibrillation in future and develop stroke. So LA strain can predict a future atrial fibrillation. Now, this is a 75-year-old lady, hypertensive, normal sinus rhythm. She was hospitalized 1 year back with LVF and paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. So this was her paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, and she just got spontaneously converted to normal sinus rhythm. And she was in heart failure with normal ejection fraction. However, over this 1 year, she had a worsening exercise capacity. Her GLS is perfectly fine, but let us look at her left atrium. Her left atrium is not only enlarged, but her strain is hardly 10%, okay? So this lady is already in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, but her left atrium tells you the story that she is in heart failure, and not only that, she has got a higher incidence of developing paroxysmal atrial fibrillation and strokes. So ladies and gentlemen, let me touch to the future. Now, I have taken this CMR image, and you can see that the apex and the base doesn't move because the base is attached to the pulmonary vents and the apex is fixed at the near the sternum. So what goes up and down is only your mitral annulus. So you have got a piston-like motion of the mitral annulus. So when LV reduces in volume, LA increases in volume, and vice versa. Now the whole thing, you can look at the LA-LV as a single complex and can take a strain of the entire LA and LV. And this is very interesting because this encodes a lot of things. If you know the entire, you can track the entire and LA and LV, you can actually see the rate of change of volume during systole and diastole. So if you see, if you take this cardiac cycle, the ventricular volume and the atrial volume, the rate of change of volume you can actually plot from this. And this is nothing but the mitral Doppler flows of early diastolic flow and the atrial systolic flow. Same thing, if I can just look at the rate of change of strain of the entire left atrium and left ventricle, then throughout the cardiac systole, I can monitor the left ventricular rate of change of strain and so also the left atrial rate of change of strain. And this is nothing but the tissue Doppler of the mitral annulus. So we have that entire information here for a diastolic function assessment. And MR can do a lot of progress into this. So this will be a single step, single bit, multi-chamber, fast and fully automated and Doppler-free on operator-independent way of finding of diastolic dysfunction on just cardiac MRI images. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Bukle. Thank you, Priya. That was really fantastic and a very nice summary and showing us multiple cases. Really enjoyed that. I had a lot to learn from that, and I've also got many questions. Some of the questions have also come from the other speakers and delegates who have attended. Dr. Bukle, your camera is off. If you can please switch that on so we can have you, we can watch you as we are asking you questions. That would be great. In the meantime, let me ask this question to Dr. Priya. Priya, how did you go about setting this up? I know you got a software which was able to do this. And did you do some normal volunteers to say this is what the numbers are? Or did you just start doing in every case and seeing what it looks like?
Basically, as you rightly said, the software is the main key. Since my machine got upgraded with the software where the strain software was possible, we started especially doing for the oncology patient. We started cardio-oncology practice in our hospital where we started obtaining GLS for all the patients. Those patients were undergoing 2D echo as well. So we compared our results. But then I realized that we are doing CMR for all the indications. And it is just basically routinely obtained SSFT images. 2-chamber, 4-chamber, 3-chamber. We just have to make sure that all of them are obtained in correct plane. And now it is just no additional sequence, nothing. It is just a processing tool. our results, basically, since then we started doing it for all patients, we did it for at least normal, healthy individuals as well. Patients coming for any CMR indications, we always, as a post-processing, along with ejection fraction, GLS, it's like, you know, long axis view, it gives an indirect estimation of the function and a calculation of GLS. So approximately 25 to 30 patients. And I was fortunate because, you know, echo department also was doing it. So we had our results which were comparable. So
that was my other question. When you say the GLS, at least, for example, if we take, was comparable between cardiac MR and echo, were the values same or were they in that there was a conversion factor between the CMR and echo?
Actually, what we found, you know, since we are, as you know, there was an inter-vendor change or variability even in echo. However, now it has been quite standardized because of the efforts of IACI. So currently the machine that we are using or the echo pack we are using is from GE. And currently what we are using a particular multi-vendor software for our MRI GLS calculation. What I find is that we are getting only 1% point less GLS value. So there's not a very vast difference. Okay, so if I'm getting here 20%, I'm gonna get 19% there. So actually they're quite comparable.
Okay, so that is good. So you have a range. So if it's minus 19, you know, it's normal. So if it becomes different, then it makes. In the explanation that Priya, you gave us, you said the 2-chamber, 3-chamber and 4-chamber gets put together and the strain gets analyzed. And the map which we get, is it a composite of all the three together or is it three separate maps that we get?
So basically, it depends on the software. And the software what I use definitely requires all three long axis planes. So I have to have 2-chamber, 3-chamber and 4-chamber, all three planes plotted together. And it is a composite of all where we get a color-coded display, 16-segment module and a polar plot and a total value. GLS value. So till now, most of the companies do not have it, but Siemens has already established a sequence. I mean, Siemens already have inline as well as a processing tool of strain, and they are giving it as a research tool to other. I mean, I think they are waiting for the FDA approval, and I'm sure Philips also has strain. So most of the vendors also will have strain. So it is important that we realize the value of using the strain parameter now. So whether it is vendor neutral or machine related or different softwares, we know that this can be possibility.
So just to confirm, you're saying that you put it, your software that you use needs all of the three CINIs, but it gives one single output of everything. Is that the same in echo also, Dr. Burkule?
Yeah, it is the same thing. That you have to have these three images because otherwise you won't get all the regionals, all the regions of the left ventricle because you need all the coronary perfusion territories. So the similar way you get the same polar plot. So you have to have these three. And now with the artificial intelligence, these machines are identifying these images from whatever you have taken. So it does the same thing for the CMR and now the newer echo machines are doing it the same. You have to just click one button and all the three images are there and you get the GLS.
And the value which comes, for example, you were showing that GLS of this patient was minus 19. That's like an average of all the 17 segments of the patient put together to give that value?
True. It is the global value. And the global value is the only robust value. Currently, I think both the speckle tracking or the feature tracking MRI have not evolved to that level that we can believe into the segmental values. Because the segmental values, you have a lot of variability, so you cannot use it for the follow-up. But the global one has got a lot of, is quite a robust parameter and it is already quite matured over the last 10 years with a lot of literature in the echo. And I'm sure the MR is going to follow the same path.
Let me ask this question which Dr. Ajoy has asked from Bangladesh. Dr. Ajoy wants to know, is strain imaging better than mapping sequences? Because mapping is also able to pick up early fibrosis or interstitial fibrosis. Is strain imaging going to be even better than that? Or is it just a surrogate marker looking at the same thing?
I think it's a very, very pertinent question. I'll just give a comparison with echocardiography. In echocardiography, we did not have something to look at myocardial characterization. Okay, so we just had some ultrasound backscatter which didn't work well. So this was the first time that the deformation was possible to measure on echocardiography. So initially they did it with the Doppler and then they did it with speckle tracking. So it's the first time that the echo can tell you about the myocardial characteristics. In MRI, there is a different challenge. MRI already has got two other methods of characterizing the myocardium. One is the T1 map, another is the extracellular volume measurement, and third is the replacement fibrosis by LG. So it is a very tough order for the GLS to make inroads into MRI and show its additive value over and above the T1 maps, ECV maps, and the LG, because they are just looking at the pathology. But what I feel is that it will still be useful as an adjunct. You find some T1 values which are, say, just 100 milliseconds raised, or you find extracellular volume which is just, say, 3 to 5% higher, and you don't know whether it is your image quality is problem or there are some problems with the reproducibility, but at the same time you find the concurrent fall in the GLS, you will be very confident about saying that this T1 rise or this ECV rise is definitely pathological. When it is extreme, like in amyloid, you really won't need GLS. Okay, when your ECV is already 40%, you won't need it. But it is for those borderline ranges, GLS will make much difference. And probably in future, as we do more and more longitudinal studies, we'll know which parameter becomes abnormal first. Whether the T1 values rise and the GLS falls simultaneously, and whether the LG comes much later in the longitudinal follow-up of that patient. So that is how I think it will evolve.
I also agree. I think it is going to be an interesting time, and it is something which we are going to benefit from, because, you know, there are some cases perhaps we can even stop giving contrast going forward, where we don't have to do the ECV and strain imaging will become useful. Just going to one of the cases that both Priya and you spoke about with regards to chemotherapy induced myocardial injury, finding a GLS reduced is fantastic, and you follow it up and it improves. That's another thing. How chronically can a chemotherapy-induced dilated cardiomyopathy or myocardial injury last?
Yeah, it's a very difficult question because there are still a lot of studies in progress. But let me tell you that though we call them type 1 and type 2, where type 1 is a permanent and type 2 is reversible, it's not so, because people know that even with trastuzumab, you have got irreversible cardiomyopathies. The issue is like that, how to prevent it, because we are treating one disease to another disease. The patient is recovering from or going into remission from the malignancy, but he's dying of heart failure. So we are just treating one disease versus other disease. And most of these patients, as the longitudinal data has shown, is that their cardiovascular events and heart failure peaks at around 3 to 5 years after starting the chemotherapy. That means that is the whole burden over the years that accumulates to produce heart failure. So finally, the longitude is not improving. So that's not a great thing. So that is why I think the science is going in this direction, is that probably if you've got some very early markers of cardiomyopathy, you judge whether you still need to be at that aggressive level of chemotherapy, whether you have got such a second best alternative, or if you don't have, then you put some cardioprotective medications with the early fall in GLS and show that it improves the outcome over the next 5 to 10 years. And that, I think, all these trials like Sakhar trial and other things which are going ongoing will tell us the value, that either picking it early just makes us serious, or whether it really impacts patients' life, because by we can start them on ACE inhibitors or the beta blockers very early in the course, and we reduce this treading of one disease versus other and improve the long-term survival.
Understood. This question is for Priya, and this is from Romina D'Souza. They say that we need to place an RV insertion point on the software to measure strain spuds. However, insertion points are not present on the basal slice on some studies. Thus, placing an approximate basal anterior insertion point, will that alter the accuracy? Do you have any experience on that?
So basically, RV insertion point is required for the short axis view when we calculate the ejection fraction. So it is not so much of importance in calculating the long axis views, But however, the RV insertion point, even if it's not in the base, on the short axis view, even if you put it in the mid slice, but trace it along all the pathway, whether it is matching or not, in case if there are minor adjustments, which can we can modify, just to know the mitral annular plane and RV insertion point. That should give you the accurate results.
Okay. Two questions which have come very similar. One is from Dr. Ravi Batina and the other one is from Dr. Ajoy itself. Linked to each other, so I'll ask them together. This perhaps Dr. Burkule can help us with that. Is strain imaging able to differentiate myocarditis from an NSTEMI in an emergency setting? Number one question. And secondly, do you have any specific experience with pericarditis and strain imaging?
The first one I would take it. It is definitely not, because the, as I told you, the regional strains are still not very robust, but it can give you certain idea. If you have a global fall in the strain, probably you're looking at a global pathology, and in a particular clinical setting with a little thick myocardium, little thin ream of pericardial fluid and the patient's presentation, and you have a global fall in the GLS and even the regional GL longitudinal strain has also dropped to the same extent. Probably you are looking at a global pathology and it could be myocarditis. But having said that, we also know that the myocarditis can also be regional. Okay. Same thing is, suppose if you are having the fall in the strain which are restricting to a particular coronary territory, one may think that it can be an ACS. But definitely I would not advise you to solely depend on this. And as you know that we have got the highest sensitive tool like troponins, which are high sensitive troponins. Actually, it may be that it is superfluous to do the strain in the emergency room, unless you are hard pressed for time that you have got the troponin values coming a little late. So that is how I look at it. And I think the second question was about the pericarditis. Yeah. So I think the use, echocardiographers are using it in the constrictive pericarditis. It's the chronic constrictive pericarditis to differentiate it from the restrictive cardiomyopathy. And rather, that is the greatest strength of longitudinal strain to differentiate constrictive pericarditis from a restrictive cardiomyopathy. Because in restrictive cardiomyopathy, the global longitudinals are quite low. They are significantly reduced, while they are very well preserved in the constrictive pericarditis, because the longitudinal function is very well preserved in constriction. It is only that it cannot expand radially. So the GLS is very, very, very preserved in this CP. So it really makes a big difference in RCM versus CP.
Okay. I'll take this opportunity to just digress a little bit and make a small announcement for people who are interested in cardiac MR imaging. As part of the IACI initiative, the Indian Association of Cardiac Imaging Initiative, there is a cardiac MRI learner series. So people are encouraged to go and join this. You can look it up on YouTube, or you can go to the IACI website. You can learn, and there is lots of lectures which are very much case-based, and you can learn these things. Now, this is to Priya. Priya, this is something perhaps you and I perhaps can answer this together. Two things which have been asked. One is any OEM softwares which do stress imaging. So any original equipment manufacturer softwares which do that. And the second question which is related to that is, how expensive are these strain softwares at present? So I can tell you a few things. Philips of their own is developing it, do not have a product as of now. GE on their own also, this is all Emma. I do not know the echo side of things. This is all in Emma. GE in themselves do not have a product for cardiac MR strain analysis. Siemens, you were telling us something. Can you just elaborate a little bit more, Priya?
Siemens has the sequence. It is at present available on the research module, but you just have to apply through the technical team and they provide. They have the LV and RV strain, which is available with them. The current software what I'm using is only allowing LV strain. But RV and LA strain also is a possibility. So definitely at present, CMR, dedicated CMR post-processing software are required. they are expensive, which ranges from 25 to 40 lakhs. But it is the entire package where you are doing for everything, whether you are doing it for LGE quantification or T1, T2 mapping, this comes as an additional tool. And the way this path is increasing, because you know more and more echo field is advancing, sooner or later it is going to come to all the software, all the machines, because that is the way, probably, you know, early detection, and that since the field is advancing that way, I'm sure if not now, all the companies probably would be providing strain very soon.
Excellent. Okay. Let me just kind of summarize it in the manner that 25 to 40 lakhs is what you're saying is a software cost. If you're going for a new software which does everything in there, which would include fibrosis quantification, it would include your T1 mapping, ECV calculation. So that there is something else happening in the background, a little bit of personal knowledge. As Dr. Burkle said, there are lots of artificial intelligence based companies. It might come up in the next few weeks. I may come up with a proposal for institutes to take up a software on a free trial basis, which is able to do strain imaging. So watch out for this space. Probably in 2 to 4 weeks, we will have a solution very much focused on this, and we are happy to give it to institutions to take it up and trial it out. So that is something which is likely to happen in there. One of the questions which has come up, where Dr. Burkle perhaps can answer this, which says that Dr. J.C. Mohan says that, good presentations, thank you very much, but strain imaging hasn't penetrated to a large extent into clinical practice, although it has been there for the last 20 years. And so do you think this is likely to change, or do you think it's going to be the same?
Dr. J.C. Mohan is the last word in echocardiography. I think he is perfectly right, because there was a lot of enthusiasm 10 years back. But when we knew that the regional strain is not that great or is not that reliable, its use in ischemic heart disease slowly went off. However, I think there is a resurrection in the field of oncocardiology, because in oncocardiology, we really do not have much robust tools to pick up that early adriamycin induced cardiomyopathy. And I think it is going to make a big difference. That is what we feel. And that is one thing, because if you see, there is the other tool would be to look at the T2 max of these patients on adriamycin and pick up that edema early. Because the studies, at least the animal studies, have shown that when you start adriamycin, the edema comes first, the T2 max become abnormal first, then the GLS drops, then the EF drops, then the volume starts rising. So that's the chronology. So probably the T2 max will be very useful, but they will not be available so easily as the echocardiography machines and the GLS. So I think still their battle is on for the GLS, and I think probably it will make a big difference in the oncocardiology at least. And also, I think some of the patterns are very useful to pick up the amyloid and cardiac amyloid. Those patterns of cherry on top, they are very sensitive but not very specific.
And
okay, moreover, excellent.
Moreover, you are doing for the other indication, not for the strain imaging. It is just an adjunct to your entire post-processing, and it is definitely an adding value addition to your.
I think, Priya, that's a very, very pertinent point, because you're not doing anything extra. You're not spending more time. You've done the image acquisition for everything else. Yes. In MR, at least, it's just a button press once you have the software. And it will perhaps help you in guiding your interpretation in one way or the other. Not in all cases, but in some cases in there. One question which has been asked by Dr. Jai Prakash Lalwani says that, does the blue discoloration depict ischemic or non-viable myocardium in GLS independent of regional wall motion abnormality?
The thing is, it has got the blue thing tells you the stretch of the myocardium. So because the red ones are showing the shortening and the blue is showing the stretch. And you are looking it at one time point at aortic wall closure. So something which is getting stretched at that time could be just a fibrous tissue, or it could be a dyssynchrony also. That is, it has contracted earlier and now it is getting stretched. So the blue thing may be just a dyssynchrony, or it could be really a fibrous tissue or the dead tissue.
Okay, perfect. Any last word from Dr. Priya? Would you like to say anything based on all the questions? Any words of wisdom or encouragement?
So basically, I think, as I told you, we are doing CMR, and CMR already has gone in the advances of the tissue characterization with LG imaging, with T1, T2 mapping. Flow imaging has advanced so much with phase contrast. It is just that function, and we have to know the cardiologist's perspective. If they are looking, we have to think like them, so then our image and interpretation will be better. So it is a simple, easy tool, and most companies will be providing it very soon. And as you said, maybe there will be a few other companies AI related. So this has to advance, but we have to know it, how to use it, so then we can take it ahead. Yeah.
Dr. Burkale, any last words from you?
True. I think it's very exciting because it's not consuming more time. Okay, the CMR strain is not consuming any more time because you are already taking SSFP images for your volumes and EFs. So you have to just click another button to get your GLS. I think one should start using it for all the patients to get a hang of it. And what I would suggest is that I think this will be very exciting to look at whether the GLS drops first, even before you get an LGE, or before even the ECV starts expanding to a meaningful level. So it, and secondly, I think probably it may be very, very useful. It will have a niche value probably when, as I told you, the T1 and ECV values are slightly increased. And that will, and with the GLS going down, probably we'll be more confident in telling that there is some early cardiomyopathy.
Excellent. Thank you very much. I think I would like to congratulate again Dr. Hemant Telkar and Dr. Priya Chugar for coming up with this fantastic idea. Really useful, and we can see it with the people who have attended and the kind of questions that have been asked. This is fantastic initiative. We look forward to this monthly program, and we will be having exciting further topics coming for the next series. I will hand over to Dr. Telkar again for closing remarks.
Thank you, Vimal, for conducting this session so wonderfully. Thank you, Nitin. Thank you, Priya. I think one more parameter for us to add in our report as we move forward. And very rightly, as Vimal has said, the more availability of the software to the larger audience is what will make us wiser as to how is it that this particular tool of myocardial strain is going to help us. And then this gray zones between how to use it is what probably will get solved as we move ahead. Thank you, Nitin. Thank you, Priya, for a wonderful session. We see you again back on January 15th. For the second webinar series, which we have. Today's session is totally recorded and will be available on the website for all those who have missed it. I wish you all the best. Thank you all again. Good night. Stay safe. Bye for now.
Bye.